Okay, what makes a cancer cell cancer? And how does it differ from other normal cells? If you haven't watched my previous video explaining why we get cancer, go back and watch that right now. I'll figure out how to put it somewhere on the screen. I don't really know how this works. And you should watch that if you haven't, because it gives kind of the foundation that we're going to build upon. We know that cancer cells acquire mutations, and those mutations result in changes in gene expression, which just means that the instructions that the cell has that determine its behavior have been changed or altered. And so I want to talk about, what are those actual changes? What are the changes that define a cancer cell? And this video is really based on one of the most famous papers in cancer research. It's called The Hallmarks of Cancer. This paper was written by some of like the heavy hitters in cancer research. One of the authors is a guy named Bob Weinberg. This guy is like the godfather of cancer research. He discovered one of the first genes, the first mutations in a gene that could cause cancer. I actually met him one time in Boston. He's just this very humble, kind of short old man. So he's great. But he wrote this paper called The Hallmarks of Cancer. And I remember when I was first starting my PhD, this is like one of the first papers I read. So what are the hallmarks of a cancer cell? The first is unrestrained proliferation. Now, in my previous video, this is what I said, this is basically what cancer is. It's just uncontrolled cell division. And that's true. At its most fundamental level, cancer means uncontrolled cell proliferation. And so this is the hallmark of hallmarks. And what you could think of that meaning is that the genes that control cell division have been changed in a way that they're now just kind of going all the time. So cell division is really important to a cell, but it needs to be tightly regulated, right? So typically cells divide in response to signals that they receive externally. Some signal in their environment is saying, hey, we need to divide here. Well, in cancer cells, instead of responding to an external signal, now the signal is intrinsic. The signal is just always on. It's saying divide, and it doesn't matter what signals it's getting from the outside. It's just saying divide, divide, divide. It's like, you know, you could think of it like a gas pedal, and someone has just put a brick on the gas pedal. And so that car is just flying down the highway, and there is nothing that's gonna stop. And that leads to our second hallmark. The second hallmark is called bypassing tumor suppressors. There are, just like there are genes that you can activate or instructions that you can activate that say go divide, there are instructions that say stop, do not divide, slow down. You could think of it just like brakes on a car. Just like we have a signal to go in a car, we have a signal to stop, and cells are the same. In cancer, the tumor suppressors, and they're called tumor suppressors because they're genes and cellular programs that are activated that basically should prevent tumors from growing. They should suppress tumor growth. Cancer cells bypass these systems. What often happens is you get mutations in these tumor suppressor genes, making them non-functional. You know, it reminds me of, you know, where I grew up. I grew up in Canada. I grew up in this tiny town in Alberta. It is so beautiful there and so cold. And in the wintertime, the roads get covered in ice, right? So you have brakes and you slam on those brakes, it does not matter. Your car is gonna keep going. And so this is the same thing with cancer cells. So we've got a brick on the gas pedal and our brakes are not working. The third hallmark of cancer cells is that they evade the immune system. Our immune system is pretty complex, and it is going around, it's always surveilling our body and trying to recognize things that are foreign or things that are wrong, and then attacking them and killing them. That's what it's paid to do. It turns out your immune system can recognize cancer cells as bad and tries to kill them. But something that cancer cells do is that they send out signals that when they interact with the immune cells, they basically shut the immune cells down. They say, hey, there's nothing to see here. Much like in Star Wars, you know, when they're looking, when the stormtroopers are looking for those droids, and then Obi-Wan says, these are not the droids you're looking for. That's essentially what cancer cells do. They say, hey, whoa, 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 we're not the cells you're looking for. And the immune system, idiot, totally buys it. The next hallmark is called replicative immortality. I love saying replicative immortality. It's just, you sound smart when you say, you go and talk to your friends, tell them, hey, you know about replicative immortality? Trust me, speaking from experience, this is a major hit at parties. People are like, what? This guy's talking about replicative immortality. I love this guy. Anyway, so what this is that cells have a limit to the number of times they can divide. When you have a single cell and it divides into two, there's a little quirk that comes with cell division that basically puts a timer on how many divisions a cell can go through. Remember, in one of my previous videos, talked about how every time a cell divides, it has to copy its DNA. Well, just kind of the mechanics of how the DNA is copied, it ends up that the new copy, you can't copy all the way to the end of your DNA. So you have to just leave a little bit on the end that's not copied. And so your new DNA is just a little bit shorter. And so then that happens again. Now those two cells, when they divide into four, their DNA gets a little shorter. Divide again, a little shorter. And so it's kind of like this fuse that is constantly just burning down. Eventually what happens is that the DNA gets too short and it starts to send all these signals to the cell saying, we cannot divide anymore, our DNA is getting too short. Well, this should be good news because we know that cancer is a disease of uncontrolled cell division. And if cells can only divide so many times, that should stop cancer from being able to grow. Well, unfortunately, cancer cells have figured out a way around this. They figured out a way to grant themselves replicative immortality, meaning that they can divide forever, unlimited cell division. And what they do is they find a way to build that fuse back up. They find a way to build the end of their DNA back up, essentially restarting the clock. Now, the reason that they can do this is because when we're developing as a fetus, it requires so much cell division. I mean, you're growing an entire organism of trillions of cells and you're starting with just one. When we're a fetus and when we're developing in utero, that program, the program that re-extends the ends of your DNA, is active. But then once we're born, that program gets shut down. But remember, the information is there in the DNA. It's in the library, but it's just kind of locked away in some forbidden secret area. And normally our cells don't activate it. But this is what happens in cancer cells, is that some mutation happens, some change to the DNA occurs, and it ends up activating that program. It's like it went into that forbidden area of the library, found this old Harry Potter spellbook type thing, and figures out how to extend the ends of its DNA, granting itself replicative immortality. Okay, that's the last time I'm gonna say it. The next hallmark of cancer is inflammation. Cancer cells send out pro-inflammatory signals, and this changes the environment around the tumor, creating this kind of fiery, inflammatory, localized reaction. And when there's inflammation going on, it just changes the behavior of so many cells. The next hallmark is invasion and metastasis. Remember, normal cells are kind of fickle. They can only live and survive in specific environments. If you have ever worked in a lab and tried to grow cells in a dish or things like this, you know this very well. It's not easy to grow cells. They like their environment and they don't like any changes to it. And this is true of the cells in our body. If you took some cell from your liver and stuck it in your heart, it would just die. But cancer cells change. They become very permissive that if they find themselves in some new environment, sometimes they're able to survive and even thrive and grow new tumors, which is how a tumor that starts, say, in your lungs is able to travel through the blood, end up in your brain, and then somehow start growing a new tumor in that completely different environment. The next hallmark is that cancer cells induce angiogenesis. Angiogenesis just means creating new blood vessels. When a tumor is growing and you have this collection of cancer cells, they send out all these signals that trick your body. Basically say, hey, we need a lot of blood vessels over here, and your body just responds to those signals, idiot, and starts growing a lot of new blood vessels. The next hallmark is altered energy metabolism. Cells need energy, and the basic thing that cells do is they break down sugar and turn it into ATP. And there's a couple programs, there's a couple different ways you can do that. One is a way that uses oxygen, and one is a way that does not use oxygen. The way that uses oxygen is called aerobic metabolism, and the way that does not use oxygen is called anaerobic metabolism. Now, turns out aerobic metabolism, the kind that uses oxygen, is much better. You can get a lot more energy out of the sugar that you break down if you use oxygen in the mix. I mean, just take a breath. That feels good. I mean, that is you're getting tons of energy, tons of ATP out of that. If you don't have any oxygen, your cells can still make energy. It's just not nearly as efficient, and they can't make as much. Well, turns out that cancer cells basically shift. Instead of using aerobic metabolism that requires oxygen, they tend to use the anaerobic energy metabolism pathway. And what that does is it allows them to survive and thrive even in low oxygen environments. So even though they're sending out all these signals that's bringing all the blood vessels to help bring them oxygen and nutrients, it still doesn't work that well because you just got this clump, this mess of a tumor cell. And so deep in its core, it's not going to get very much oxygen. And so what it does is it changes its energy metabolism so that now it doesn't use oxygen and is just making energy through anaerobic metabolism. The next hallmark is genome instability. What that means is it just means it's very permissive of mutations. We know that mutations are what drive cancer. Cells acquire mutations. Those mutations are changes in the instructions, and those changes in instructions lead to changes in behavior. And the changes in behavior are the things that we're talking about right now. Well, one thing that is just this reinforcing cycle is that cancer cells tend to get a lot more mutations than normal cells. And the reason is because their DNA repair pathways tend to get broken. Your cell has all of these mechanisms and systems in place that if there are mutations, that it can recognize those and say, hey, this is a mistake, and it can go in and fix it. But the problem is if you get mutations in the genes that control that system and that system ends up breaking, then you start to get mutations and your cell can't fix them. Now you have a cell that is getting a lot more mutations than normal, which just increases the chances that you will get the mutations in the genes you need to change the behavior of the cell enough that it acquires these characteristics, these hallmarks of cancer. The last hallmark is another key, just foundational characteristic of cancer cells. And that is that cancer cells resist cell death. All cells have this program, basically a self-destruct program. And that's because cells are very expendable. I mean, again, there are trillions and trillions of cells in your body. Every day you're making hundreds of billions of new cells. If you lose one, nobody's gonna notice. And cells, they're self-aware, they're team players. They know this. And so they have this self-destruct pathway. And the way it works is that if a cell just recognizes, hey, some things are going wrong inside here, they're very quick to just say, I'm out, hit the self-destruct, and then they just die. Well, the problem is this system gets broken in cancer cells. So as a cell is acquiring these mutations and recognizing, hey, something is wrong, it goes to hit that self-destruct button, and nothing happens. That system gets broken in cancer cells. What you're left with is basically this zombie cell that can't die. As much as it wants to die, it's trying to die, it can't, it continues to live on. So, these are the things that make cancer cells cancer. And really what cancer research has been doing as a field for the past several decades is as we've come to understand these unique characteristics of tumor cells, we've tried to find ways to exploit those. Let me give you one example that deserves its own video, but I'll just give you a little teaser.
Immunotherapy.
You've probably heard about immunotherapy, all right? And the way this works, this is very cool, is you know, one of the hallmarks of cancer is that they can evade the immune system. They send out signals that tell immune cells, hey, there's nothing to see here. But what immunotherapy is a drug that will go in and it will bind to the cancer cell and prevent it from sending that signal. And so the immune cell interacts with the cancer cell and says, hey, you're not supposed to be here, kills the cancer cell. And by just changing this aspect, stopping the cancer cell from hiding from the immune system, been able to completely cure some previously incurable cancers. So that's just one example about how learning about and studying basic cancer cell biology can lead to new treatments in the clinic that have real significant impact. Thank you for watching. Like and subscribe. That's what people say on these things. So like and subscribe, only if you want to. No pressure here. We're all friends. We're just hanging out, talking about cancer. But if you ever loved me, like and subscribe.